This too will pass. I am a worker bee, not a queen bee, and this is alien to me. I do believe that you've drawn the short straw. I was in the wrong place at the wrong time. Our wonderful Anna Mackenzie, where are you? Yeah, I'm after you. From our TQI, greeted my principal, Susan Skinner, and I as we arrived for the presentation of the ACT Highly Accomplished and Lead Teachers certificates last November. With her engaging smile, she asked if I would be interested in doing this gig. Before I could get my head around the request, my heart had stopped beating, and I was desperately trying to reply in the negative without using any swear words. When my principal chipped in and said, of course she would. I am a nobody. I am just a teacher. Wait. But I have, as you heard in the introduction, been successful in renewing my certification. I still find it a bit of a shock to realise that I pulled off what I thought was the impossible twice. The whole process of reflection on one's achievements or failures over the past 5 years is a bit of a wake-up call. I did not, at the beginning of my time as a certified teacher, even consider that I had to get out there and make a difference. I have always worked hard, tried to do my best, and if along the way improved outcomes were noticed, my response was always, I'm just doing the job I am paid to do. 2017 was a year of reflection for me. We were up for our school review, and I was up for renewal of certification. The teachers at Ebbett were all asked to find evidence for each domain in the school review process. This involved many hours after school over 6 months. But the upside of this was that I had no time to reflect on my own achievements, in effect putting my renewal aside to be worried about later. In looking for evidence, I had data from middle years mental computation for 4 years, which showed continual growth, and NAPLAN showed the numerous results were tracking more steeply than the average across the country. At the beginning of last year, I was informed that my role would change to a coaching role. This was a result of my deputy waking up at about 2 a.m. and having a brain explosion about how best to use teachers to improve student outcomes. I must add that his first idea would have terrified me. Teaching numeracy from kindergarten to year six, I am in no way a kindergarten teacher, and admire them hugely for coming back day in and day out. I equate kinder teaching to having a bucket full of corks, neatly submerged under my widespread hands when one cork bobs up, and in trying to get that one down, the rest bob up. So well done to the kindy teachers. So net result is chaos. Fortunately, he had a rethink, and I was told, go weave your expertise and magic with years 3 to 6. My first reaction was, I have expertise. You think I weave magic? How? My principal and deputy see me differently to how I see myself. My role at Ebbett is a coach from years 3 to 6, and our literacy and numeracy officer works with K-2. Thank God for that. And we had been in this role for 6 months when the panel arrived to assess us. We were both interviewed first up on day one of the school review, the idea being to give the assessors an overall picture. Didn't do anything. I told you this is not me. The idea being to give an assessment of the overall picture of the structure of the school. So when the first question was, well, what is your role? I blurted out, impact coach. This was a term I'd heard at last year's summit in Sydney. And I liked the term and decided, yeah, I don't know, who was it? Was it you? Yeah. So thank you, you saved me. And I would become an impact coach. There is no point, I thought, in going into a classroom if you don't make an impact on the teachers and ultimately on student outcomes. So I sat in front of the review panel and ever so confidently, I explained that I was an impact coach. I explained that my role was to demonstrate high-quality, engaging lessons that catered for a wide range of abilities we all have in our classes these days. I told her that I use mental comp, I'm a system facilitator, as a means to impact on the teachers and students. With approximately 70 students sitting on the floor in front of me, three teachers watching and taking notes, I wove my magic. I would teach one mental comp session each week, and then the teachers themselves would take the next lesson the following day when I was not there, giving them time to have a go themselves without me eyeballing them. In hindsight, this method worked very well without me being there, but I'll get to the results later. After the review in which we received a commendation for our impact coach growth model and an affirmation for our work improving student outcomes in maths, I kind of had a feeling that I might be doing something good and was pretty chuffed when the review chair quietly praised me on my work. With review over, I had now time to look at my own evidence to prove that I was still the person I was in 2012. What had I done? Nothing. I told myself to look harder and consider anything I had done. So when I arrived at Ebert in 2012, I noticed that maths was not a priority. In other words, it was a lesson that was either dropped to be used to finish off some writing, or even art appeared to be a better option. I started to make noises about maths and English being equal, and was eventually told to back off a bit because I was making people uncomfortable. I found this strange, as there was an urgency in correcting this error if we were to make our students numerate and to improve NAPLAN results. I naturally pushed ahead and was eventually given extra time off class to go and demonstrate. Something's going on. I'll just stand here and not talk. I lost my place. Can't remember what I was going to say. I was given time to go off, so I identified that I would need a lot of kid glove treatment to cajole, support, challenge, model, mentor, and coach my colleagues to improve their practice. I showed them how easy it was to differentiate activities to suit the needs of all students, and slowly but surely, maths became a worthy cousin of English. I also presented extensive professional learning opportunities to my colleagues. My school had gone from an underperforming one from a national perspective to one that is performing well above average. I am a middle years mental computation facilitator here in the ACT. It is a program that runs from year 5 to year 8, and somehow I made it work from year 3. A number of years ago, I attended one of those PLs that you quickly put your hand up to attend as it would get you a day off school, which, considering where I was at the time, was a much-needed break. This PL changed my perspective on how we teach mental computation and is now the tool I use to tune students into liking and even enjoying maths. I deliver mental comp to schools when they request it. Two of us deliver the program over 5 2-hour sessions. I have delivered this program many, many times, both in after-school sessions and as two-day courses during stand-down. I absolutely love seeing the faces of the participants change from resignation because the school has signed them up for this PL. Can I share with you my experience from my own class last week? It's really good to get feedback and know that you have converted more teachers to making maths fun. There's one game we play, Dead Dice. Favorite, hands down. Anyone here play Dead Dice? Listen carefully, it'll make you a star. 5 6-sided dice. I, the teacher, roll them. The idea is if you roll a 6 or a 1, the 6 or the 1 are out and you can't count what's left. Do you understand? So they're dead. You roll the 3 again, and if you get a 6 or a 1, they come out and you're left with whatever is left. If you don't roll a 6 or a 1, you're allowed to count the pips. Yes? So I use this game to make sure that the children are not doing a nose count, which is... yeah, or a... we need them to trust that that 3 is a 3 without nose counting. So it's a great game. So I play it, and I do my round, and I write Mrs. S up on the board with my score. And the idea is that then the children play, and when they get a better score, they put their name up and their score. And after 10 minutes, the winner gets a fruit break, which, sorry, Natalie, but they're actually Skittles. They're blueberries and strawberries and watermelon. I actually had a student who made me a Skittle machine. It's a jar that you turn upside down, it's got a handle that you push in and you pull out and a whole little Skittles come out. So that's my fruit break. Anyway, I play the game. So students enjoy beating each other. And I do not lie when I tell you I usually get a big fat zero in this game because I roll and there's a six and a one and I roll again and there's three sixes or something. I make a big deal of being disappointed. The woo-hoo. And bless these children sitting on the floor. You'll get better, Mrs. Steward. You will. You'll be good. Trouble is, this game is all about luck, and I have none. You know you make a difference when, during the summer holidays, an adult you vaguely remember from somewhere stops you in the street and starts telling you about how mental comp has changed the way she views maths. Or how about the quiet sense of pride I got when I asked one student a few weeks ago how he worked out 501 takeaway 63. This is a child who had a traumatic year last year, has the face of a cherub, and has always comments on how much he loves mentals. He also knows that it has always been fine to get answers wrong. He looked past me, and as if it was the most normal conversation in the world, said, I took one from 501 to make 500, then I took 60 away to make 440, and then I took two off to make 438. I could see him visualizing the endless number line in his head. Not bad for a below average student. At the end of the semester one last year, I had model lessons and expected my colleagues to implement successful strategies in their teaching. It was time to hand over the reins. I created a scope and sequence for them to follow, added a myriad of activities to support the newly learned strategies. The kids call them games. We are learning, not playing, and having fun. And sat back and observed. I armed myself with AITSL's classroom practice continuum and a highlighter and was blown away by Susan, the first to go on the 3-4 team. The energy she brought to the lesson was tangible, the students highly engaged, and her questioning was deep, eliciting answers showing the depth of the students' knowledge. It was then that I realized that she was performing just like I do. At the end of the session, I was humbled as it had been such a privilege to watch her lesson. Her continuum of practice is still proudly displayed on the wall next to her desk. This year, she plans to apply for certification as a highly accomplished teacher, which is also ditto for the next teacher. Again, such a privilege to observe outstanding teachers performing at their best. At this time, I suggested it was time to start preparing their own portfolios of evidence, and I started to support three colleagues to gather and annotate evidence for their own certification later this year. As a team, we then began to look at the data and the effect we might have had on our students. More on that later. I also worked with ACARA to create work samples to be included in the portfolios of assessment. It's kind of really cool to see your own work included in something all teachers across Australia use. I worked closely with one of ACARA's maths consultants who flew to Canberra a few times to work with me. I do believe my credibility as a maths teacher at my school has been enhanced by having work included in the portfolios. I take great delight in telling 5-6 teachers to use those two examples for assessment purposes. I assure them that they are very good, but make sure to teach the content properly. I have had strange looks in the past when I've added that they are mine. Most people don't believe me. Next time you, as a 5-6 teacher, use a portfolio pieces from the Australian curriculum, have a look at Spring Fair for Year 5 and fill it up for Year 6. Yep, they're mine. Prior to this, the only time I'd be involved with effect size was when our school priority was spelling one year. We were given carte blanche to make a difference, record what or how we did it, and we would review later. My team leader at the time was doing some sort of leadership course and took our data to create an effect size. She then emailed John Hattie to ask if she had worked it out correctly, and he actually replied. His response was, yes, but the question that needed to be answered was why had one teacher a greater effect size than the other? What was that teacher doing that the other one wasn't? I was that teacher, so thanks, John. Thanks for allowing me to think that as a lead teacher, I intrinsically knew how to teach and teach it well. So back to the 3-4 team and effect sizes. We had the data in a substantial amount of time between assessment periods. When we saw the results, they had to be checked again. With the aim to be effective teachers, we were looking for the magical 0.4, but what we as a team got was 0.6. We thought we were the bee's knees. We shared the results with anyone and everybody, and even those who had no idea what we were talking about. And as a school, we had been rabbiting on about effect size for some years. The euphoria lasted a long time. I even shared this news with my own family, who smiled encouragingly, not understanding a word I was saying. So back to my own renewal process. I did get it done, obviously, but I wasn't without many self-doubts. Anyway, I pulled it off. Of all my achievements over the years, ACT Primary School Teacher of the Year, certification at LEAD in the pilot program, where no one could tell us what or how the portfolio should look or be presented, working with the CARA to develop assessment pieces for the maths portfolios, the renewal of my LEAD teacher certification is the second sweetest. The sweetest achievement? 2 weeks ago, I took the data from Mental Comp and compared the start data in February 2017 to February 2018. The effect size of year four to year five was 0.9. The year five to year six was 1.6. But the one that had my heart racing, and I knew it was racing because I have a watch that has my heart rate and my heart... I could feel my heart doing something, and I looked down, it was 134. But the one that had my heart racing was the year three to year four. Remember, the program I'm delivering is for year five to eight, and I've given it to year threes who sat and looked at me like, what the hell is she doing? The effect size was 1.69. I rushed around the school to show the 3-4 team how awesome we had been over the course of the past year. It means I finished my career on a high, not as a loser who should have retired, but as a person who now believes that sharing my expertise has had an impact. People often say, oh, you're a good teacher, you're a great teacher to me, but how do they know if I don't know? I do now. As one of my colleagues wrote, as an impact coach, she has mobilized teams of teachers to achieve colossal gains. Glynis is truly an inspirational teacher whose abilities are only matched by her wry sense of humor and self-effacing modesty. I make a difference, and I have the proof. I am a great teacher. I am somebody.